technical session on cybersecurity. How do we go ahead and deal with the, you know, all the ransomware, whether it's WannaCry, whether it's the new one, the BadRabbit. I think a lot of technology colleagues from the industry following me in the rest of the session for the rest of the day will be going into a lot of these technical topics and how do you build and evolve a cybersecurity strategy. The topic that I'll be covering on is how do we engage with the board? And when you say board, it's not just the executive board, it could also be your senior business leadership, which is your CEO, CFO, and the, or your entire business leadership of an enterprise. And for all of this, I personally think the key word that I have written here is, how do you craft a collaborative approach? Because the challenge in every enterprise is, there are a lot of silos when it comes to the entire enterprise risk management strategy and enterprise risk mitigation strategy. There's risk that is taken care of by finance and audit. There are risks which are taken care of by maybe in the manufacturing sector, your entire shop floor management people. It could be risk being mitigated by the operational managers. Then there is IT, then there is risk, and then there is security, information security teams. So the entire evolving or crafting a enterprise risk management strategy and an enterprise risk mitigation strategy usually is siloed unless you're an extremely mature enterprise with a very mature enterprise risk management. And we don't see too many of them at the desired level of maturity, not only in India, but across the globe. And that is why we have challenges of how does the enterprise step up its ability to deal with the current challenges of cyber risk, which many of the senior speakers in the inaugural session talked about. So that would be the focus of my session. So when we, why do we have this conference? Why do we have this InfoSec Global Conference? The only reason is that we see the entire world, every enterprise, whether it is a small and medium business, whether it's a very large Fortune 100, Fortune 50 company, whether it's, you know, the large diversified conglomerates, it's a bank, it's a payment bank, and also government organizations, whether it's even law enforcement or anybody doing, you know, supply chain management in government, transportation, all of them adopting digital technologies. So if you see here, there is an ubiquitous connectivity happening through cyberspace, which could be either on the internet, using cloud technologies, using mobile technologies, and it impacts every domain that you can think of, whether it is, typically when you look at digital, I think what comes to our mind very easily is the entire technology-enabled solutions in terms of retailing or e-commerce or digital payments that banks and financial services. But it's a fact of life that the digital footprint is coming up in very traditional enterprises like oil and gas, who are trying to integrate information technology solutions with their operational technology solutions, which typically used not used to really adopting deep dive digital technologies. Even if you look at the way oil rigs are managed and maintained and monitored, there's a whole lot of infusion of digital technologies that are happening. Even in the morning session, a lot of speakers talked about IoT. We see the penetration of IoT, and particularly when you look at the smart cities mission in India, I think the IoT proliferation is going to be quite a bit across the nook and corners of the countries in domains or in use cases and scenarios that we have not really imagined. So even if you look at housing in which some of us live in multi-story complexes, we see a lot of infusion of digital technologies, whether it is RFID enabled, you know, boom barriers, whether it's surveillance, whether it is, you know, smarter fire detection controls. So a lot of domains, we are not just talking about a Fortune 100 company or the very large diversified conglomerates or the top 10 banks who are, you know, resorting to all of this. So when we look at the technology ecosystem, why am I spending this time on drawing this landscape of the digital technologies, aspirations of any enterprise? Because this is what the board cares for. The board really does not care for how many firewalls you have deployed, is your patch management up to date. The board or your CFO or a CEO really does not care for whether you're procuring the latest technologies, are you using machine learning, are you using threat intelligence. They really don't care for all of that. They're looking at business growth, stakeholder, meeting stakeholder expectations, meeting investor expectations, servicing consumers with a new league of services and products, using digital technology. So typically, if you look at what are the technology trends and business, we see robotics, IoT, and the social media, and analytics and cloud. And robotics is no longer, you know, gobbledygook or, you know, technology geeky thing. You go to a shop floor in a Maruti, or you go to a shop floor in Mahindra's, or you go to a shop floor in a two-wheeler plant anywhere in the country, you will notice the kind of robotics that has been deployed in the manufacturing shop floor plant. Similarly, when you look at the fourth industrial revolution that is getting built, where you talk about manufacturing 4.0, there is a whole lot of industrial control systems and SCADA and IT and OT getting integrated. You talk to any energy major, you talk to any oil and gas exploration company or oil and gas marketing company, refining company. There's a lot of focus on industrial control systems, which used to be siloed from your enterprise IT, getting integrated. This IT and OT integration using digital technologies is something that we keep hearing about. Similarly, we talk about India transitioning from a data poor to a data rich nation. There's a lot of data driven technologies, not just for offering new products and services in the banking or financial services world, but there's a lot of data driven technologies in analytics and fraud detection, in anti-money laundering solutions that get better. There's also a lot of data driven thing in terms of automating your processes, automated decision making based on, you know, some alerts that your machine learning or other engines throw up. So, what does the board bother about? Any board? This is a slide from the McKinsey NASSCOM Strategic 2025 report that we released last year. All that they look at is an enterprise that is configured for strategic and operational value using either established conventional enterprise technologies or emerging technologies. An emerging technology could be blockchain. Emerging technology 2 years back was cloud and mobile and analytics. Whereas now when you look at emerging technologies, an enterprise management is looking at how do you harness artificial intelligence, how do you harness machine learning, how do you harness blockchain for solutions, and how do you track using these digital technologies the shifts in the landscape that we are seeing in terms of consumer behavior, consumer experience. So all these, I'm not really getting into each of this. It could be the technology that is used for channels. For example, in banking sector, multiple channels are being used to service a customer, whether it's payment banks, it's UPI, whether it's BEAM, whether it is, you know, the conventional ATM-based credit card, debit card kind of transactions. So there's a lot of channels. Similarly, if you look at retail, there's a whole lot of channels. You look at healthcare, there's a lot of alternative ways of channels where diagnostic care providers, with tertiary hospitals, with your neighborhood herb nursing home, post-operative care at your home care being done by organizations like other organization where there is home care after surgery. So there's a lot of alternative channels in every domain that you can look at. Similarly, if you look at big data analytics, everything is real time. And big data analytics is not just in wealth management solutions that banks or financial services are doing. We are looking at big data and analytics in core enterprise solutions. So when you look at the paradigm shift, which is what the management attention is all about, is the today's enterprise priorities have a paradigm shift. The paradigm shift could be, how do you innovate on services and products? Again, I want to repeat, this innovation in services and products is happening in healthcare, is happening in manufacturing, is happening in banking. They're looking at end-to-end process digitization. So it's not just core banking and internet banking. You're talking about end-to-end process digitization from the way you acquire the customer, the way you do your KYC or KYR, and the rest of the way life cycle of the customer. This is happening in education field. This is happening in healthcare. Similarly, lot of enterprises are looking at sentiment and behavior analysis. Behavior analysis could be insider behavior analysis in terms of employees. Behavior analysis could be, or sentiment analysis could be, is what is the market feed? What is the consumer saying on social media platform? There's a lot of technology infusion that is happening to be able to do this. Similarly, all of us know that what was core enterprise solutions sitting behind the firewall in your secure intranet is now moving to third-party data centers, is moving to global clouds. Lot of them are integrating with public clouds. So core enterprise solutions are making calls to the cloud, based on which gets probably opened up for cyber risks and new vulnerabilities, which probably an enterprise IT or a CISO or a risk manager would not have planned for. And a very interesting thing is, even in compliance management, the life cycle of compliance management, which is what keeps a risk professional awake or a CISO awake in 24/7, is you're collecting data, you're analyzing data, you're learning, and you're acting on that data. Enterprise is doing that. Your entire risk, cybersecurity, your CISO organization is just ingrained in their DNA to be able to collect, analyze, learn, and action. They're continuously collecting this. In these life cycle of these four steps that any enterprise risk and CISO team will look at the kind of technology. When you look at collection, probably some time back we had OCR, right? Automating forms and getting data. Whereas now there's a lot of collection of data with speech and facial recognition. It is happening in authentication. It is happening in, you know, registration time. You can go ahead and give your biometrics. You can register your voice for activating your IVRs. Similarly, if you look at expert rules-based expert systems, whereas now we are looking at a lot of data mining so that your machine learning engine can be trained to look at those data, look at those patterns, particularly in the area of fraud detection in financial services. We are seeing this solution and these technologies becoming mainstream. Similarly, there's a lot of deep learning, and there is natural process learning and robotic process automation. Robotic process automation is happening again across verticals. So if these are the cybersecurity imperatives of the digital world, what are some of the risks that management worries about which the CISO or the chief risk officer should be able to brief their boards, brief their managements, and be able to, you know, mitigate and reassure them that the business or the enterprise is in safe hands. So that some of the attacks and threats, whether it is the expanded surface for attacks, previously you had to go through your enterprise firewall, whereas now the attacks can happen through the mobile solutions you have deployed. Attacks could happen through your fire detection IoT devices, or attacks could happen through some physical systems that you have deployed, like HVAC systems. We have seen all of this. And there have been very high impact attacks on your critical infrastructure. Similarly, risk of information theft, because there is an end-to-end digitization process, an end-to-end online delivery of services, the risks are obviously becoming multifold. So if you look at what is the national response, when we say national response, I'm talking about a response not only from government, from organizations like CERT or Ministry of IT. It could also be a national response from a regulator like RBI or IRDA. It could also be a response from industry members, each individual enterprise. So there's a certain response that is happening, but are we prepared enough to be able to deal with the cyber risk? Globally, we are seeing that there's a lot more that needs to be done at the government level, national security institutions level, bodies like CERT, and of course at an enterprise level, and bodies like even DSCI are continuously evolving today. So if you look at the cybersecurity crime issues and challenges, which is what gets board level attention thanks to all the news, what is the nature of threat which any board will want to evaluate? Just like maybe the board in an IT industry will worry about the volatility of the dollar. Maybe a manufacturing company will worry about the volatility of commodity pricing, right? But when you look at cyber risk, these are some of the points on which any senior management, executive management worry about. Whether, you know, there is cyber espionage, there can be a cyber security risk because of which there would be a policy or an, you know, there is an IP infringement. These are some of the issues that any executive management of an enterprise worry about. Some of the organizational challenges to be able to deal with these threats, right? There's supply chain security, whether every product and solution that you're deploying, is it really safe enough? Is it secure enough? Similarly, we look at cybersecurity practices of SMBs who could probably be your suppliers. There are a lot of SMBs who are supplying to you, whether it is in the auto sector, because that supplier is integrated with your enterprise. Similarly, it could be a small SMB which is giving you a mobile solution which you are deploying in your enterprise, maybe for employees or for your consumers. Similarly, when you look at domestic issues, there are a lot of cyber attack breaches. Reporting is still an issue. Resolving in a timely fashion, information sharing between the sectors and within the sector is still an issue, and there are some increasing hacktivism in the cyberspace. So similarly, when you look at global challenges, I think the dark net or the dark web is one of the biggest challenges which law enforcement globally, organizations like Interpol or even NSA of India, finds it difficult to deal with. So when we look at stakeholder concerns, there are a lot more. All I'm trying to say is, what does the board get briefed on by a CISO versus what is the landscape of the threat at a country level, at an enterprise level, at a sectoral level, and that threat landscape is evolving. So these are broadly the cybercrime issues and challenges. And what do we do as a risk professional or a CISO? Another 2-3 minutes, please. What do we do as a risk professional? I think we, bamboozle the senior management with all the thefts, which worries them even more on should we be going digital. Instead of that, all we are saying is we need to engage with the board on cybersecurity. And I have some recommendations which I've picked up from some global reports, including the Gartner reports, on how do you engage with the cybersecurity on cybersecurity with the board is not by getting them worried about all the attacks and all the losses, but some recommendations that I have in terms of an integrated enterprise risk management. Keep determining what is acceptable risk. Share with the board on what is the technology solutions, people, process, technology that Dr. Bal talked about. What is the vendor management strategy? What is your procurement strategy, which is ensuring that you're mitigating the risk? How are you continuously investing in cybersecurity as a percentage of your overall IT budget? And still, there is no 100% risk mitigation. There would be some residual risk. I think the board would like to know what is authorized acceptable risk, and if there is residual risk, how are you trying to mitigate it? And there will be some risk. It's a trade-off that the organization . How do you make sure that the enterprise risk management has enough automation to be able to track? These are some recommendations. And in terms of the preparedness for the enterprise, I think there are few areas: risk management and oversight, regulatory compliance. I cannot not highlight the fourth point. What sometimes misses is supply chain security, because when you're provisioning an enterprise IT architecture and solutions and an enterprise risk management technology solutions, you're sourcing a lot of solutions, you're provisioning them some on the cloud, some on your intranet, maybe some on your third-party data centers. You're sourcing something from micro enterprises like a startup, and you're sourcing something from large global enterprises. How do you ensure that your enterprise risk management strategy does a proper supply chain security management? That is the only thing. And if some of you all are representatives of the boards or senior management, because a lot of hands organization, I would say these are principles of, these are not mine, these are principles of this National Association of Corporate Directors, which are, I think, good principles for the board, that don't make cybersecurity briefing by your CISO 10 minutes in one of your annual board meetings. How those briefings should be more regular, more periodic, and how do you ensure that the enterprise risk management framework and the mitigation strategy, the business and the IT and the CISO team are well aligned. That's all I have. Thank you for your time. I'm around and I'm happy to take questions.